celebrating women. First Lady Michelle Obama and Secretary of State Hillary Clinton mark International Women's Day side by side. And a celebration of extraordinary women tops our look at stories around the news nation. First Lady Michelle Obama and Secretary of State Hillary Clinton kicked off the 100th anniversary of International Women's Day in Washington, D.C., where women from around the globe were honored for their courage and leadership.
They are here today because each of them at some point made a decision. At some point, each of them decided that she simply could not carry on in the face of an injustice. We do this to send a clear message to all of you, our women of courage, and to women like you all around the world, that you are never alone in your struggle.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And welcome to the State Department. We are so pleased to be hosting this 100th anniversary celebration and to have so many distinguished guests. I want to start by thanking Milan. As most of you know, Milan Verveer is our ambassador at large for global women's issues. And I want to recognize that she has been a woman of courage almost every day of her life, but she also deserves an award as a woman of stamina. She travels on behalf of the Obama administration almost endlessly, Mrs. Obama, and she just keeps going year after year, chipping away at the problems that affect women and girls and that affect national security, economies, peace, and stability. It is a great pleasure, once again, to be able to celebrate this day with the First Lady of the United States, Michelle Obama. Mrs. Obama has done so much to support, inspire, and challenge women and girls here at home and around the world. You see her in our schools with American children. You see her in the schools of India and elsewhere with school children there. And everywhere she goes, she sends an unmistakable message that she and her husband, who happens to be the President of the United States, have two daughters that they love and support and are providing the direction and discipline that is needed to raise children, and they hope, as we all do, that every child would have the same opportunity to live up to his or her God-given potential. I'm also delighted to welcome the first woman Prime Minister of Australia, Julia Gillard. The Prime Minister is a wonderful partner in our global efforts to advance the important issues that Australia and the United States share in common. And in particular, she is focused on improving opportunities for women and girls. And when her visit with President Obama was scheduled and she learned that it would coincide with this occasion, she quickly said she wanted to be here. And I was lucky enough to spend time with her last year in Melbourne, and now we're cooperating on everything from solar power to security, but with a special attention paid to the daily lives of women and girls. We're also honored to have with us Cherie Blair, who has started a wonderful foundation to help women entrepreneurs. And we are working together on the M Women Initiative to tap the power of mobile technologies to empower women. And I'm delighted that you could be here with us as well, Cherie. And finally, I want to thank our token man. Lloyd Blankfein, CEO and chairman of Goldman Sachs, he has helped to support and pioneer a program you'll hear more about in a minute. that really does go into developing countries and work to improve the economic and business opportunities of women. And we're pleased that Lloyd is here and will have an important announcement to make. Now, in addition to these remarkable women who are sitting up here on the stage with us, we also have the participants from the 100 Women Initiative that we launched yesterday. These are established and emerging leaders from business, academia, civil society, media, medicine, from every region of the world. They are fearless advocates for the rights of women and for fundamental human rights and democracy. And they are going out around our country not only to work with Americans in various fields of their interest, but also to exchange ideas about how do we empower people to build their own futures and to do so with skills and support from the rest of us. And then finally, I want to welcome this year's 10 winners of the International Women of Courage Awards. Each and every one of these women is remarkable. I have known some for many years. Some I'm meeting for the first time today. Now, I have to say, we've never before given an award to a head of state. But we were so inspired by the tremendous courage, leadership, and tenacity shown by the first woman to lead a Central Asian nation, President Rosa Otunbayeva of the Kyrgyz Republic. In the face of a collapsing government, regional divisions, economic privation, she emerged as a unifier, someone who kept Kyrgyzstan whole after tragedy and upheaval. She is a president who knows how to lead, but she also knows how to let go, because she has set an extraordinary example of what it means to relinquish power. She decided early on she would help to set up a new government, have a new constitution. And when the time came, after the elections were finished, she would turn over powers to the new prime minister and that government. In so doing, she has offered an invaluable lesson to fledgling democracies everywhere. Because we know, of course, that elections alone do not produce democracies. It is that willingness to share power with other elected officials, to build democratic institutions, to hold a second and a third free and fair election, to transfer power peacefully. That's what allows true democracy to take hold. And this is a woman who I think can stand as an example to many leaders around the world about what democracy and power should be used for, to help the people that you are supposed to serve. Now, for anyone raising children in today's world, it seems that there are not enough heroes and heroines. So I am particularly privileged to honor 9 other women who have truly done heroic work to advance freedom, equality, opportunity, and equality and dignity for all. They've risked their lives, they've served in prison, they've been harassed and oppressed. Sometimes their own children's lives have been at risk. They have been insulted, beaten, and tortured. And yet each of these women has found the strength to persevere in the face of fear, isolation, or repression. And they've done so not just one day or one year, but day after day and year after year. Now, 2 of our honorees, Nasta Palazanka from Belarus and Yoani Sanchez from Cuba, could not be here because their governments would not allow them to travel here. But we are with them in spirit, and we salute them for everything they are doing on behalf of their countries and their people. Now, as you hear more about each of these women from Mrs. Obama and from me and from the citations, you will understand that each has pushed the envelope of what was considered permissible. And they have been inspirations, and I believe they can inspire generations of women and girls who follow after. Now, I was struck to learn the other day that our planet that we all share is now host to the largest generation of girls and women ever born. There are now more than 850 million girls and young women aged 10 to 24. What kind of world will they inherit? What kind of world will their children inherit? How will they lead the next generation? Who will they look to as models? The women in this room all know how to lead by example. Henriette, who's working for good governance in Cameroon, or Jian Mei fighting sexual harassment cases for women in China, Eva seeking to stop so-called honor killings in Jordan, Marie Selah, who is starting a federal witness protection program so cartels can be prosecuted in Mexico, Maria insisting on defending women brutalized by domestic abuse even after her own home was set afire in Afghanistan, Agnes defending the rights of Roma women from a seat in Hungary's parliament, or Ghulam insisting that every girl in her rural Pakistani village deserved to be enrolled in school. Each of these women, and I mention them in a personal way because this has been a personal mission for them, they have reached down deep and done what was necessary. And I often wonder how many of us, including myself, under those circumstances could have done the same. Their courage, their compassion, their commitment, their quiet moral authority has come from putting the well-being of others before their own. Now, we have seen similar tales of courage from women across the Middle East in recent weeks. They have insisted that their voices be heard. And in the coming months and years, the women in Egypt and Tunisia and other nations have just as much right as the men to remake their governments, to make them responsive, accountable, transparent. The United States will stand firmly for the proposition that women must be included in whatever process goes forward. No government can succeed if it excludes half of its people from important decisions. We saw women out in force in Tahrir Square in Cairo. They were clearly saying they expected to have a voice and a vote in the future. And I noticed that last week, a group of Egyptian women wrote to the Constitutional Committee of Egypt asking why none of Egypt's distinguished women legal experts had been invited to join in drafting constitutional amendments for the transition to democracy. We will certainly be watching, and the world will watch. And it's not just the rest of the world, but the women themselves who deserve to be at that table, making those choices that will affect their lives and the lives of their daughters and their sons, no matter what government emerges. It will take more than democracy to create real opportunity and stable societies. It will take jobs and economic growth. So I am delighted to announce that we are launching a new partnership designed to help businesswomen in developing countries make the most of their talents. The Goldman Sachs Foundation's 10,000 Women Department of State Women's Entrepreneurship Partnership. It's a mouthful, but it's a really critical effort to provide scholarships for 100 women entrepreneurs over the next 2 years. And we intend working with Goldman Sachs to make sure that these scholarships help women receive world-class business and management training. The first women will come from Indonesia and Haiti. And I'm delighted that Lloyd Blankfein is with us to announce this partnership, which will supplement the Goldman Sachs 10,000 Women program, which has already been such a success. It has already educated more than 3,500 women in more than 20 countries. And the evidence shows that these women have been growing their businesses, boosting their profitability, creating new jobs for others. Women run small and medium-sized businesses, drive GDP growth all over the world. In fact, they are one of the highest yield investments we can make. So I thank Lloyd, and I thank his creativity and vision for this exciting venture.
But I want to start by thanking my friend, Secretary Clinton, not just for that very kind and generous and warm and heartfelt introduction, but she is one heck of a Secretary of State. She has...
To Hillary Clinton, keep fighting for us.
TeamHillaryClinton.com.